कनिष्क सर। हाँ ओके, हाँ ओके। சார்லஸ்
சார் ரெண்டு ரைட்டு ஓகே சார் ஒரு நிமிஷம் இன்னொரு செட்டப் மட்டும் பண்ணிட்டு நான் சொல்றேன் இது ஓகே சார்
சார்லஸ்
ரெண்டு ரைட்டு ஓகே சார் ஒரு நிமிஷம் இன்னொரு செட்டப் மட்டும் பண்ணிட்டு நான் சொல்றேன் இது சார் ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணலாமா சார்
ஆ ஐ அம் வெயிட்டிங் ஃபார் யுவர் கால் ஒன்லி
எஸ் சார்
குட் மார்னிங் ஃப்ரெண்ட்ஸ் குட் மார்னிங் ஃப்ரெண்ட்ஸ் வி ஸ்டார்ட் நவ
வி ஆர்
ஆல்ரெடி ஆன் தி டைம் நவ சார் சார்லஸ்
ரெண்டு ரைட் ஓகே சார் ஒரு நிமிஷம் இன்னொரு செட்டப் மட்டும் பண்ணிட்டு நான் சொல்றேன்
Dear participants, please mute your audio because lot of echoes are coming. Charles?
Yes, I am ready, sir.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, dear friends. I welcome you to the another interesting session, which will be given by Dr. A.V. Jayagopal. He is a retired additional director from Atomic Mineral Directorate. Department of Atomic Energy, Government of India. And his topic is on atomic minerals exploration in our national building. When I talk about Dr. Jayagopal, Dr. Jayagopal has completed his BSc and MSc Geology from Presidency College, Chennai in 78 and 1980. And he's completed his PhD from Bangalore University in 1995. Dr. Jayagopal joined AMD in 1981 as a field exploration geologist. And he has worked as field exploration geologist in various positions until 2004. From 2004 and 2012, he was promoted as scientific officer G grade. And he was in charge of Andhra Pradesh and Rajasthan state in AMD operations. And from 2012 and 2015, he was a deputy regional director. It was actually scientific officer H grade in Northeast region, Shillong. Dr. Jayagopal has been promoted as additional director for Southern, Western, Northeastern regions in 2015 and up to 2018, he was holding that post. And he was promoted as additional director and H plus grade in 2018, and he was retired. And he has retired from the government service, but he still is a member in Exploration Research Advisory Committee of AMD. I can list out his scientific contributions. So many contributions, sir. I have quickly read out because time is going. Dr. A.V. Jayagopal is involved in discovering classic carbonate hosted Thummalapalli uranium deposits, Kadapa district, and it is the world's one of the largest uranium hosting deposits. It's producing around 160,000 tons. And he's also involved in commercial mine. He has established uranium deposits like Gandanpale in Kadapa district. He has established uranium and REE mineralization in the Sivana ring complex in Balmer district, Rajasthan. He has established low-grade multi-metallic uranium deposits in West Siang district of Arunachal Pradesh. He has discovered unconformity-related uranium deposits in Kapartala area of Kurnool district of Andhra Pradesh. He has discovered and disseminated uranium mineral deposits in Mastipuram area of Varanaparthi district, Telangana. And he has established South Central Regional Office for AMD in Hyderabad. So all these are his findings, and over this 37 years of his experience, he has done so many things. And he's also a life member in many societies, and he is a member in many professional organizations, and he has been awarded as adjunct professor in Homi Bhabha National Institute, AMD Complex, Hyderabad. He has published more than 40 referred national and international journals. So he has published papers in all these journals. And I can say so many things for Dr. A.V. Jayagopal, and I can take 1 hour of his time. So I'm just stopping here. And I request our respected, esteemed resource person to present his presentation. Thank you, sir. Dr. A.V. Jayagopal, sir, please.
Thank you. I'll share my slide. First of all, I welcome everybody, and my greetings to each and everyone. At the outset, I congratulate Professor Devanathan, Principal, President's Autonomous College, Professor B. Gautam, Head of the Department of Geology, and also convener of this webinar program, and Mr. Charles, who is the organizing secretary of this. My co-speakers and research scholars and people who are viewing this program in YouTube from far off places. So let me talk about my topic. Yes, my topic is slightly different in the sense, this is regarding the energy or the electricity. I often wonder, geologists are, if any go to a public and ask about geology, I don't know how many people be able to say what is geology. That is because of the reason we are not like doctors or construction engineers or agriculture people. So their output or their end product is directly matters or felt by the common man in day-to-day life. In this way, I am talking about atomic energy, which matters in our life. Of course, say for example, even we use, common man use minerals and right from the time he gets up and go to the bed. For example, mobile. See, mobile main component is a chip that is made up of the rare earth element. So that's how geology is very important for a man in day-to-day life. I'm going to talk about one such aspect, that is energy or the electricity. We are going to see what is atomic energy, what is atomic minerals, how it is explored, and where it is explored. And atomic energy, because many people may not be well aware of atomic energy. Atomic energy is just like any other energy, say thermal energy. In thermal energy, you use coal in the power plants, thermal power plants. It is very same here also. Instead of coal, it is uranium or thorium. The setup where this uranium fuel gives energy converted into electricity is called reactor. So with this simple understanding, let us go ahead. Okay, so let us see the present position of in India. So in 2007, our installed capacity was about 150 gigawatts. It has increased to 350 gigawatts in 2018, and we are the third largest, only behind China and USA. So International Energy Agency projects our demand will triple.
Gautam sir,
by 2000.
Kekudu.
It will triple,
Gautam sir,
by 2040.
Charles, kekudu.
From 2013 till 17, about 115 million people have gained the access to electricity. That means they are given power.
More than
115 people gained access to electricity. So raising of 80 to 86%. But all this enhanced power capacity, but still our reliability is not up to the mark. So the in 2018 global competitive report has ranked as 80 among 137 countries in the reliability criteria. It is going to increase 156% by 2040 because of our prosperity and population growth. All these things are required telling about the power positions. Let us go. So we have been talking about the energy. Energy is given by many sources. Basically, we can classify into non-renewable source and the renewable source. Non-renewable source means once it is taken out from the mother earth, it is exhausted. So it is something like coal, natural gas, oil, or called the fossil fuels. Of course, nuclear. And renewable energy is, it is replenishable, like rainwater, solar, wind, and all. So here, the nuclear energy is, you can fit into both the things. Nuclear energy, in the reactor, you give the uranium, which is taken out from the mother earth. But in the reactor, uranium, you see, a lot of some people are talking. It's
interrupting.
So, in uranium, is also called the non-renewable, also renewable, because when the initially we will be seeing that the latter phase of my talk, that to start with, you feed the reactor with uranium, which is taken out of mother earth, but later on, this uranium breeds into multiple byproducts which serve as the fuel in subsequent stages. So this is about the distribution of electricity percentage wise. You see, the fossil fuels are contributing about 63%. Say coal is 54%, gas is about 7% and all. So hydro is 12%, nuclear is only meager 2%. And RES is renewable energy sources. So this is the pie diagram. Same that I have put. You can visualize it better because the coal is contributing about more than 0.5%. You see, coal is good, fine, no problem. But you see the emission of these fossil fuels, the CO2, it is going to double by 2040.
Jagopal sir,
it is going to, yeah.
Jagopal sir, please please keep your mic nearby, sir.
Okay.
And don't allow the mic to shake. Yeah, little buffering is there. Little buffering is there. Please don't shake the mic. Please just keep the mic nearby your face.
Okay. Are you able to hear now?
Yes, sir.
Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Please, sir. Please continue, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So the emission is going to increase by 14% by 2040. So what is the effect of all these things? See, all of us now, we are well aware of global warming and all. The global warming main culprit is the CO2. So yesterday, one of our friends were talking about the Madras flood of 2015, and some scientists have related that the El Nino phenomena, which has happened in the ocean. So these are all caused by the global warming, that is by the CO2. And again, of course, the vehicle population and all. So we want a clean energy. We want a better energy. So in that way, we have to look for, and not only that, these fusel energies are also required for future generation. So we have to go for the energies which are renewable. In that way, let us nuclear energy is important. Why nuclear energy is needed for us? Let me see energy equivalent. 1 kg of enriched uranium can give energy equal to 100 tons of high-grade coal and 60 tons of oil. And it protects the air quality. It is zero emission. According to one estimate, about more than 14,000 million tons of carbon dioxide between 95 and 16, say equivalent to removing about 3 billion cars from the road, were reduced because of the global warming. Another thing is, it occupies a very small place. It occupies about, say about 1,000 megawatt, which is in Kodamplam. Similar to that, I'm not talking about Kodamplam specifically, it is for the understanding. So windmill requires 360 times and solar requires 75 times the space. And it is a minimal waste. And this is about the nuclear energy. So we can think of the hydro. Hydro is having the problem of the rivers. You see, everybody cannot stay near a river. So only some nature has gifted only to some states. Whereas this nuclear energy can be planned, that is, reactors can be at any place. So this is about some positive points about the nuclear energy. So let us know what is nuclear energy. So nuclear energy is the energy contained in the core of the atom. That's called nucleus. So nuclear energy can be used to generate electricity. It can be released in two ways. One is nuclear fission, nuclear fusion. So the nuclear fission is splitting of a large atom and smaller atoms. So there is a difference between the weights of these two, small atoms and large atoms. That difference of weight is converted into energy. So this setup happens in reactors, where the splitting of a larger atom into smaller atoms and the release of energy, that energy is converted through the so intermediate steps, finally we get the electricity. So in nuclear fusion, it is other way. Two small atoms are fused, and in that, the energy is released. So that's what happens in some helium. Helium atoms are combined under very high temperature, and they are fused. Can you imagine what is the amount of energy released from the sun? So these are the two things, this previous experience. So why I'm talking about this? So the atomic minerals are the basic fuels for this nuclear energy. So how important the energy in our daily life is goes without my saying. So the history of this nuclear energy in our country. In many countries, atomic program came as the offspring of their strategic program or their later military research. Whereas in India, it became as an objective to improve our quality of life and also self-reliance. On these objectives, 10th August 1948, Government of India constituted Atomic Energy Commission under Atomic Energy Act 1962 to establish the Atomic Energy Program. And the minerals comes under this act are called atomic minerals, like uranium, thorium, beryllium, niobium, tantalum, and all, which are all used in the Atomic Energy Program. So when this Atomic Energy Commission was formulated, our great scientists like Homi Bhabha, they wanted to review the what is the availability of raw materials like uranium and thorium. Based on that, they wanted to create an energy program. They found that we have got limited uranium resources, but vast thorium resources, which is the large one of the largest in the world. So Dr. Bhabha, Homi Bhabha, who is the father of Atomic Energy Program of India, conceived three-stage nuclear power program for different uses of energy. So this three-stage program is what fuel type, where the spent fuel of the previous stage is used as the fuel for the next stage. So this is the manifold energy potential of the fuel and reduces the quantity of the waste generated. This is the diagrammatic representation of what I have talked. We have got three-stage nuclear program. First stage is pressurized heavy water reactor where our natural uranium is used, and the purpose is to use to build the fissile inventory. The next stage here, we get the plutonium. This plutonium is used as a blanket with the uranium 32, that is thorium 32. Thorium 232. This is converted into 233 by the plutonium. Then this U-233 is put around the natural thorium, which we get from the eastern west coast of India as beach sands in form of monazite and all. So finally, with the limited resource of uranium through the intermediate stages, we are going to use our vast resource of thorium so that we are the self-sufficient and we are also in a position to supply anybody. It's a vast resource. And these are about how the uranium helps in producing energy and all, but it is not an easy thing. There are a lot of challenges in the world. See, we have tested the Pokhran 1 in 1974 and Pokhran 98. So we are shown our nuclear capabilities to the world, and so there is a technology denial. And there is one NNP, Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, which makes all the other countries to visit our facilities and research activities, in which we are not interested. Because we want to excel. Hello. Audio signal. Internet. Then I will convert into another thing. But there will be a break, no? You are not getting my voice, sir. Okay. But if I have to change the internet, I have to change it other source, no? Okay. Now there will be, I have to cut it again, enter, no? Okay.
Sir, can you hear me?
Hello?
Can you hear me?
Hello?
Sir, can you hear me?
Gautam?
Sir, கேக்குதா நான் பேசுறது கேக்குதா?
Hello? Gautam?
Sir, நான் பேசுறது கேக்குதா சார்? சார் நான் பேசுறது கேக்குதா சார்?
ஹலோ
சார், நீங்க கனெக்ட் பண்ணிட்டீங்களா? கண்டினியூ பண்ணுங்க. நீங்க கனெக்ட் பண்ணிட்டீங்களா?
கண்டினியூ பண்ணுங்க. So what are the challenges? We have shown our capabilities in 74 and 98 by the Pokhran testers. So then naturally our capabilities are absorbed by the entire international community. Then another non-nuclear non-proliferation treaty, which allows all the activities, research activities, to be viewed by each and everybody. And the another prohibitive test is about the cost. It is very costly, initial cost. As the time passes, the cost will come down. And the non-availability, the high-grade uranium fuel. So we require vast electricity. So, but the main issue is about, we can see, about the site selection and public acceptance. So people are not aware of what is atomic energy. And there are a lot of misconceptions. So there is a lot of awareness is required. So there is a problem in this nuclear industry. And finally, it is not about any energy which is good or which is bad. We require different sources provide for different benefits. Each energy has got its own negative and positive. We want the combined sources, but only thing is uranium has got lot of positive points. So this is about the many people have got the misconception about the dangers of the nuclear energy. So there is one estimate which says there is a death about this coal industry 161, oil is 36, natural gas so much in all. Whereas nuclear is supposed to be this much. Now coming to our main thing, our geology. So we have talked about the atomic energy, how it is created, and what are its utilities, and what are the challenges. Now our main business comes, how geology comes into play in this atomic energy. I may not be surprised, but many of the students or the many people may not be knowing how the geologists are being engaged in nuclear industry, that is atomic energy. This presentation will help them. First is the nuclear fuel cycle, which describes from the exploration from the one end to the another end, that is exploration to the waste management. So uranium exploration is done by the Atomic Mineral Directorate for exploration and research. That is, it deals with the exploration and evaluation. It talks about the exploration, the grade, depth, the tonnage, leachability, and all the technical aspects of that. And it's 3D, where it is rich, where it is poor, all those data is done by the AMD. Then when it is established that is sufficient quantity and quality is available, it is taken over by UCIL, Uranium Corporation of India Limited. They do the mining and metallurgy. They are the end product. They give called LOK, ammonium diuranate. This is the basic product which is supplied to nuclear fuel complex, where they are preparing this nuclear fuel assembly, which are required to be set up in these reactors. They are called bundles. Here the nuclear energy power is created. Then the leftover waste is managed called by waste management cell. So you can see geologists are involved here. And again, in waste management cell. So from the fore end to the back end, geologists play a very, very important role in nuclear fuel cycle. Then let us see how the uranium is explored. So there are three components. One is field component, and what are the stages, and the laboratory. So the field, it is a remote sensing followed by the geophysical and ground surveys and geochemical surveys. Then it is in geological ground surveys, we got reconnaissance, semi-detail, and it is when you find something with all this background, geological input, remote sensing input, geochemical input, when you delineate and ground gamma ray spectrometry, this is the basic tool for a field geologist. These are the eyes of a field geologist, that is uranium geologist. Without this, you cannot identify the radioactivity. So with this, all these tools, he goes for the survey, and if he gets some activity, that's called a reconnaissance stage. Then when you get something interesting, then you take up the drilling, that's called exploratory. When you find something continuous in the down dip, that is in the underground also, you will do in a regular systematic way, that's called evaluation. Then the reserve estimation, then we see the beneficiation, the called leachability, how much uranium we can be taken out, and then the evaluation. So these are the different scales, regional scale, sub-regional scale, and it's all a big topic because the constraint of time, I can't go into these details. And then at the different stages, in the remote sensing stage, we do literature survey and geophysical and the geochemical ground survey and all, photogeology and all. Then when it comes to the ground reconnaissance and semi-detailed surveys, we do the petrometrology and analytical study and all isotopic study and all. And when it comes to drilling and reserve estimation, finally the overdressing, where the mineral beneficiation, when what acid you use, how much oxidant you have to use, what is the time you have to allow, all those things are characterized. Then coming to our main business, where do you find uranium in India? So in uranium is found basically in five geological entities. One is a Kadapa uranium province, where we get this unique carbonate hosted stratabond Tumalapalli, Rachakuntapalli. This is what Mr. Gautam was referring. More than 1 lakh tons of uranium has been established. This is a world-class deposit. It has been identified as a type by itself. IAEA, International Atomic Energy Agency, has classified, has given a status of a type by itself. Then comes the unconformity type. This strata bond type occurs in the southern Kadapas, I'll show in the map subsequently. And this unconformity type occur in the northern part of Kadapa Basin. They are occurring in Lambapur, Pedagattu, Nalgonda, Telangana, in Guntur district, Koppanur. Next is the Singhbhum Uranium Province. This is Domesia, Wakin, Wakur, Gomagat, and all in Meghalaya. Next is albitite, that is in Rohil, Sikkar district, Rajasthan. Another Bhima Basin, that is Karnataka, in Yadgiri district, Gopi. So we'll see the contribution from the different types. The carbonate type is more than 50%, metamorphite is 26%, sandstone, this is occurring in Mahadex, Meghalaya, is 9%, protozoic unconformity, this is in northern Kadapa, 8%, metamorphite, there are small contribution, 3%, and granite late at 1.56, protozoic, you see, is 0.1%. Then we can see the same thing here. We can see this is a protrose. This is a map of India broadly. Actually, uranium mainly occurs with the basin, sedimentary basins rather than igneous complex. So it is mainly in the protozoic and phanerozoic basins, not in the RKN basement crystallines. Of course, we get, but they are very limited. So these are protozoic basins, which are in blue color. And this magenta is the phanerozoic basins. In this setup, broad geological setup, we get unconformity type protozoic basins and strata bound uranium mineralization. Then in phanerozoic, you get the sandstone type, equal to sandstone type of the US and many advanced countries. And we get vein and metamorphic type and in the QPC. This is a very interesting type, which talks about the transition between the anoxic and oxic conditions in the base of the Baba Buddhas and the iron ore series and all. Then we get the one calcrete type, which is associated with the calcretes of the modern days. The same thing I am talking about the deposit wise. One is this Tumalapalli, and this Lambapur, and this Jaduguda, this Singhbhum shear zone, and this is Domesia, that is in Meghalaya, and the Rohil, it's in Rajasthan, and Karnataka, Gopi. And we are coming to the further details. The first and foremost, which contributes more than 50%, is this strata bound. Tumalapalli, Vasukunta, Kannampalli, it is about 160 kilometers, a vast belt. But we can't say the entire belt, how much potential is. But the central belt, about 7 kilometers around Tumalapalli, Rachayottapalli, is more than 100,000 tons of uranium has been established so far, and it is continuing. It is very, very, very fantastic deposit. So one entire lecture can be on this type. So but the time constraint is there. I can't go much detail into that. It is one of the laurels for our country. It is the best deposit. It is associated with the Vempalli dolostone. It is strata bound. It has got very characteristic features. And then comes the unconformed type. These things are Lambapur, Pedagattu, and Chitri. These are the Srisailam outliers resting over the peninsula gneiss and cloister granites. So that unconformity is mineralized. This is comparable to the Canada and Australia, but the difference is There you get the pelletic sediments as the basement, whereas here you get the granitoids as the basement. So the pelletic sediments are better than the granites. This is the Singboom shear zone. Here only the first uranium mines have been started. Very famous Thoramudi Narva Pahad, Botin and Moldi Bandurong, and also entire belt is mineralized. And number of uranium deposits are there and occurrences are there. And it is ever green, just like our strata bound of the South Kadapa Basin. This is about the albitite type. This is something like a metasomatic type. The origin is still not clear, but the presence of albite is called as an albitite. Due to many geological processes, the albitite is formed. In the dilation zones, we get uranium mineralization as lenses. This is one of the very prospective areas. Number of areas are, this is the basin. This is North Delhi Fold Belt. This case, Delhi Fold Belts are divided into North Delhi and South Delhi. At the contact of the, they recall the contact of certain Kali Guman lineament, you get this mineralization. It is quite interesting and ever potential. Another area, of course, South Aravalli also, Umbra and all, it is all related with the calc silicates and all the calc metasediments. And coming to the South India, we have this Karnataka, where the geological map of Bhima Basin is displayed. These are the various faults dissecting this upper Proterozoic Bhima Basin. These faults are mineralized. This Gobi, this another unconformity type. The importance of this, this is the highest grade of uranium in India. For the certain specific reasons, I cannot discuss about any grade or thickness and all. It is only, what I am talking is only about the geological aspects. Then we are coming to the, of course, end of our talk. Uranium is, well, I have talked about Atomic Energy Act 1962 deals with the uranium, thorium, rare earth and rare metals, which are used in the atomic industry. This RMRE, what you call, include the columbium, tantalum, spodumene, lepidolite, xenotime. They are main sources from the pegmatites and riverine places as the residual deposits. The other source is the mica, Bihar belt, Rajasthan belt, Nellur belt, and also alkaline complex of Andhra Pradesh, and pegmatites including the greenstone belts in Karnataka. Now, how we go about this? We do basically a first survey, the geological work. We will locate the pegmatites. Of course, pegmatites are marked in the map and all. The specific type of pegmatite is required, whether it is zoned or unzoned. Unzoned pegmatite can't give you anything. The zoned pegmatite is required. Once the pegmatite is required, we go for this the presence of residual or placers. Then once we find some columbium, tantalum, or any RMRE minerals are found, we go for the detailed pitting and sampling and the beneficiation process. Then we come to the other very important field of atomic mineral directorate, that is B-sands, where you look for monazite. They occur mainly in the east and west coast of Indian Peninsula. The minerals are monazite, ilmenite, rutile, zircon, garnet, and sillimanite. This is done, explored mainly by auger drilling and other sonic drilling. Now recently, techniques are updated. are estimated mainly by the individual samples and composite samples. They go for, they will see each mineral, how much by volume it is available, and it is calculated for kg or for the ton like. So this is about the map showing the beach sands and inland places. We can find these are Visakhapatnam coast, Dharampur and all. So this is beach sand deposits of Andhra Pradesh, and in Tamil Nadu mostly it is in southern part, and in the western Kerala also we get a lot of deposits. So we are almost coming to an end of the talk. So we have seen what is, why we require atomic energy when there are number of sources are there. All sources are important. It is not a debate about the technology versus technology. It is only to see the advantages. So nuclear energy is, you know, how important the electricity for us. And population growth in India, we require a lot of energy. And also, in fact, per capita energy consumption is an index to judge your quality of life. So quality has to improve. So we require more energy, so more uranium. So in that scene, we have seen the what are the main important areas in India to look for uranium and also thorium and argon. Now come to an end. Thank you.
Sir, thank you, sir.
Hello.
Sir, thank you. Sir, hello. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, will you please go back to the slides of Kadapa? Kadapa map showing Kadapa. Hello, sir. Sir. Sir, will you please go to the. Hello.
He's talking mobile.
Huh?
My talk is over, no?
சார் நீங்க கடப்பா ஸ்லைடுக்கு போய் எக்ஸ்பிளைன் பண்ண சொல்லி சொல்லிட்டு இருக்கேன் நான்
புரியுது ஓகே
மறுபடியும் உணர்ந்து
கடப்பா ஸ்லைடு
எஸ் 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 யூ கீப் யுவர் ஹெட்போன் கரெக்ட்டா மைக் வந்து பக்கத்துல வச்சுக்கோங்க சார்
சார்
ஓகே அந்த கடப்பா ஸ்லைடுக்கு போங்க சார் அங்க இருந்து கொஞ்சம் சொன்னா போதும் சார் நவ
யூ ஹேவ் சீன் தி என்டைர் டாக் நோ
டாக் ஐ ஹேவ் சீன் அந்த கடப்பால கொஞ்சம் எக்ஸ்பிளைன் பண்ணா நல்லா இருக்கும் அது நிறைய இன்ட்ரஸ்ட் ஆயிடுச்சு
That is the lower, middle, and upper. The lower to middle is kept around 1600 to 1800. The upper is kept around 900 to 800. So the Kadapa Basin age is Paleoproterozoic to Upper Proterozoic. Because it is number of datings have been done. It has varying from 1.GA to 2GA, which fits into the early Proterozoic. And this Palnad and Karnool, they are about 800 to 900, this upper Neoproterozoic. So they are resting over the crystalline basement, that is peninsular gneiss with injections of the close-bed granite, and a lot of schist belts are also abutting against it. So this contact is marked by the famous FRKN unconformity by the Gulcheru quartzite and conglomerate. So it is basically divided into the Vempali formation, and Gulcheru quartzite and Vempali constitute Papagani group, and from here Pulimedala quartzite, Tadupatri shale, Gandikota quartzite, these are called as the Chitravadi group. This entire basin, it is called the Papagani basin. Actually speaking, this Kadapa is not a single basin. At one stage, it has not formed. It's a tectonic basin. It is a mosaic. It is a mosaic of oval-shaped Papagani basin and a spindle-shaped Nallamalai basin and this flat-lying Srisailam basin. First the Papagani basin has formed, and then because of tectonic upheaval, the sea has migrated towards the east. Then this Nallamalai sub-basin was formed. When this Nallamalai sub-basin has completed, there is again an upheaval and then the migration towards the northwest. That's the Srisailam is formed. And again this plateau is uplifted and the migration towards the north and also the south, the Kurnool and the Papagani, rather the Palnad basins are formed. There is a lot of interesting things that are coming up in this. It is a wide potential deposit. In fact, and this is it's a huge topic. So this is a plate tectonics boundary. Here the Darwar Craton is there. Here it is the Eastern Ghat Mobile Belt. And there was a thrusting from here. Because of this, you get this concave shape. And coming to the uranium mineralization, we get four types here. One is this strata bound type. Another is the unconformity type. And we get here also, they are called shear controlled. They are called Kasturi Gattu, and number of small mineralized zones are there. They are along this. Another very important zone is you are finding these small lineaments. These lineaments are occupied by the cataclysites. These cataclysites are also mineralized, and their contact between these sediments and these lineaments are also important. And another very important type of mineralization is coming up in the Gulcheru, originally what was thought as the thorium only. Now it is a lot of uranium mineralization is recorded along the fractures in the Gulcheru quartzite. So that's why the Kadapa basin is called as Kadapa Uranium Province.
Sir, thank you, sir. Thank you. There are some questions.
Hello.
Sir, there are some questions.
Hello.
Sir, there are some questions. Shall I ask, sir? Yeah. Hello. Sir? Jay Gopal, sir?
Some audio problem is there.
Jay Gopal, sir? Jay Gopal sir, hello.
Sir, call panni solrunga sir.
Any questions?
Our answer.
Jay Gopal sir. Jay Gopal sir.
Kelvin.
Jagobar sir, sir, can you hear me?
Any questions?
Sir, can you hear me? Jagobar sir, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Our headset lighter now, sir. So ask him to headset and clearly. Okay.
Headset,
okay. Headset, can you hear me?
He's
not using good. I thought.
Sir, Jay Gopal sir. Sir, and the headset nalla computer la sorunga sir. Headset nalla idula sorunga sir. Headset system la nalla sorunga sir. Sir, kekudhungala sir? Sir, kekudha?
Hello.
சார் கேக்குதா சார்
எனக்கு கேக்குது உங்களுக்கு கேக்குதா அண்ணா
ஆ மொபைல் ஆஃப் பண்ணிடுங்க சார் நான் பேசுறேன் சார் மொபைல் ஆஃப் ஆ தேர் ஆர் சம் क्वेश्चंस சார் தேர் ஆர் சம் क्वेश्चंस ஃபர்ஸ்ட் திங் இஸ் how AMD control manages the groundwater pollution in Tummapalli area where uranium is extracted? Because there in that Tummapalli groundwater pollution problem is major problem. Hello. Sir, can you hear me, sir?
The same problem, sir.
Or I'll come into. Hello.
இருங்க அப்படி நீங்க அதுல பேசாதீங்க நான் இதுல இருந்து பேசுறேன் ஹலோ ஹலோ கேக்குதுங்களா சார் ஹெட்போன் எடுத்துருங்க We'll send the questions to you. You can type and send the answers. There are so many questions.
Yes, sir. You can send I'll go to that presentation.
இப்ப கேக்குதா சார்?
Message in this WhatsApp. I'll go to that presentation.
நீங்க ஃபோன் பேசுதா அவர் பேசுதா இந்த ஃபோன் மூலமா கேக்குறீங்க?
நீங்க ஃபோன்லயே பதில் சொல்லுங்க. ஃபோன்லயே பதில் சொல்லுங்க. நான் லிங்க் பண்ணி விட்டுறேன்.
Okay.
The first question is in Tummapalli area there was a groundwater pollution problem.
Yeah.
And how you tackled that problem?
See, the groundwater pollution is we have got the in the tailing ponds and all lot of precautions have been taken and a study has been done by the BRC Bhabha Atomic Research Center and they have found that pollution is not well proved and because of the simple reason there are the generations or people are living now with a lot of vegetation like plant rather plantain and lemon and lot things are coming up and people are utilizing it see the pollution is and a lot of things are coming up just active and counteractive unless detailed studies are completed and proper official representations and all comes then they will be taken by the
okay.
What okay. we are talking is and basically as I told I am not talking about the other technique that's the basic thing
sir I have a question sir
only I can entertain the geological question not anything else we are geologists we are not public to talk about the for the geological aspect and the importance of the nuclear energy and studied and by the expert groups and it has to be sorted
sir one more question
yeah
kindly elaborate how remote sensing was useful in Pokhran blast.
See, as I told now, these things are all, it's not about the geologist. Geological students are not worry, need not worry about this, how the Pokhran tested and how it was monitored by aerial survey. Let them talk any geological questions I will educate them.
Sir, I have got
it's
one
not
question.
About the atomic energy. I am not. It is not the purpose of this this webinar, I understand.
Okay.
Sir, I have got a question.
Yeah, please tell me, sir.
Kanishkan.
Tell me, sir.
Can you hear me?
See, as I told now, we are this webinar series about the what I am talking about the advantages and disadvantages, different sources to make the people. That's what the very purpose of my talk is, not to teach geology. This is what I wanted to say. This is to make the people to take, they can find a taste in geology on the atomic minerals. It is something like, when you come to a party or when you come to a big restaurant, you are given an appetizer, just like a soup, so that you will eat more. So the purpose of this talk is to make the geology student how the geology is important in atomic energy. Let them not get diverted into the pollution, how the Pokhran blasted. That is not the subject of this talk. And okay. These questions cannot be let them ask any how the mineralization takes place. I'll be very happy to answer, and that is not
okay,
the value
sir.
Of this.
Sir, okay, sir, okay. Yeah. And what would be the source for beach places?
Yes.
Are the beach places are feasible to take electricity? That was another question.
Yes. See, beach places are derived from the inland granulites, pondlites. Podorites, and also this is the provenance. This is the provenance for the beach sands. So regarding the one is two types of places. Yes, this pondlites, podorites, and all the coastlines bordering the coast are the provenance for these beach sands. So how the beach sand can give uranium, that's what the student should followed. That is the third stage of the Indian nuclear program, to use the thorium. Thorium is from the monazite. From that thorium is extracted. That thorium is used in the power plants. That's how you cannot directly put the beach sand into a reactor.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So next question, what is the cutoff grade required for uranium and thorium explorations?
This cutoff grade internationally and all, it all depends upon the cost. The final cutoff grade varies, and these are all not the marketable things available in the thing to, it is not for the public enterprise person to go for a cutoff grade and decide whether he has to go for it. It's only the government purview. As far as the public is concerned, it's anything. The general clocks value. Let us talk about the geology. Clocks value of a granite is a general abundance. What we call a 4 ppm. In granite, it is 12 ppm, and it is much more also. When it is goes more than 200 or 300 ppm, it is taken as a cutoff. It varies from country to country. Yeah.
Why the sir? Why thorium is mostly found on beaches?
That's
in contiguous belt.
Sure. See.
Tell me, sir.
Places are found. You know the basic reason is the places are found at the deltas or the rivers where it meets the beach. That is the provenance first stage. There is a number of cycles are there. First is in the coast, all the sediments from the inland are carried towards the ocean by the so many small big places, rather the rivers and rivulets and all. That's the first. Then that's a winnowing action by the ocean. The waves come and go and come. So they concentrate these minerals. So that's why they are segregated based on the specific gravity. Heavy minerals stay back as a sand, and the light mineral, which are quartz, feldspar, and all, is taken away by the ocean. So they are, by the continuous winnowing action, and the concentration takes place. So that's why there are two. If you see the eastern coast of India, if you see the regional, there are a few degrees of the rather the slope towards the ocean, eastern coast. So there is, that's how most of our rivers are flowing toward the east. That is one. Then the question comes, why the Kerala then? Kerala, because you have got the faulted margin. Again, there is the location for the concentrations.
Sir, will you please tell you about some tectonic aspects of that Kadapa basin? One of the question is there. Again, please explain the tectonic part of it. Hello?
Yes. Yeah, I'm coming. You are seeing?
Tectonic belt of that. Yeah.
You are seeing Kadapa basin, no?
Yes, sir.
Yes. See, this is the basement where this unconformity, Erpakhine unconformity. This is the craton, Eastern Darwin Crater. Yesterday, our Dr. Northern was talking about the early, rather the younger greenstone belt and older greenstone belt, close to granite and the Baba Budan and all. So that's all the total Darwa Craton. So in that,
yes.
This is Kadapa basin is occurring in the younger eastern Darwa Craton. So this is the craton, and this is supposed to be a tectonic basin called the rift basin. Lot of dikes are there because of the dikes, and you know there is a lopolith just below this Papagai basin. Lot of basic dikes are intruding the basin and also outside the basin. This crustal, rather the thermal gradient, has melted the asthenosphere, and there are fundamental fractures. And when the fundamental fractures, crustal sinking, these crustal sinkings are the basic criteria for the rift basin. So once the rift basin has formed, here the sedimentation started with the Gulcher quartzite, Vempalai limestone, and the Kulikandla quartzite and Dadbatri shale, and then finally followed by Gandikota quartzite. And then, you know, this Rudravaram line. The Rudravaram line is along the, this is, as I told, this is the Nallamalai basin and the Papagani basin. Oldest is Papagani basin. This is the Nallamalai basin. The contact between is a thrust contact. It is named as Majoring and Atoll. They have called it as a Rudravaram basin, rather the lineament, and this is a thrust contact. And against this thrust only, this along this Papagani, the Nallamalais are thrusted. And this this contact here, this is, yesterday he was talking about the thermal line and some suture zones and all. This is another suture zone. This is a suture zone. How the suture zones are identified? There are ophiolite suits here called chondral volcanics. And it all, and we get the, you get andesites and ultramafic rocks in this environment. With all these things, it is identified as a suture. It is again confirmed by the geophysical surveys, Kayla and et al. So this is, you know, this side is supposed to be the Western Australia. So what all the students know about is the plate tectonics of the post-Gondwanas.
Okay.
But plate tectonics has been active right from the protozoic. My paper is there. I identified the plate tectonics, which was in action during this time, that is responsible for the origin of Kadapa Basin. My paper is there in exploration and atomic research volume number. It was published in 2012. That is responsible for this mineralization and all. So this is the equivalent of the modern plate tectonics. There are in actually plate tectonics happens at regular intervals, certain peaks like 2BY and say about the 0.6. There are five peaks are identified. So it is one of the oldest pre-Cambrian tectonics we can
call. Okay, sir.
So it is quite a number of people are calling different names. This is one of the tectonic basins. The origin is due to the operation of plate tectonics.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And some more questions are there.
Sure. And,
the time is already 11:10. So conclude that the questions will be sent to you by mail, and you can respond to them also. Sir. No problem.
Okay.
And thank you so much, sir. On behalf of our principal, department staff, organizing committee, and all of us in the students, I thank heartfully for a wonderful presentation. And we have seen the entire atomic resources of India, where it has been drilled and where it has been explored and all. We can hope for a separate lecture on Kadapa.
One thing I would like to say, if you arrange this sort of, I would like to suggest you can bring out some volumes and all, and you can arrange number of webinars. We can benefit of the student community. Number of each area can be one topic.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you very much for your excellent presentation. And now I request the participants. Our next session will be on 2:30, so it will exactly start at 2:30. And all of you are requested to join Zoom or the YouTube by 2:20, so that exactly 2:30 the lecture will start. Thank you very much for us of now. Sir, please tell me, sir.
Let me thank first of all your for organizing this and my learned colleagues, also co-speakers and also your principal for organizing such a wonderful occasion and also giving me this opportunity to interact with future budding geologists.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Dear friends, dear young friends, we'll meet at 2:30 today afternoon. Thank you very much. We are logging off now. Thank you. Unless.
Okay, sir.
Unless we we'll log off. Yeah, we can. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you all.
Thank you all.